Good afternoon, Sanet. Welcome to the cave. We're so happy that you've joined us.
Thank you very much, Almin, for the invitation.
Yes, of course. So today at the cave, we're very privileged to have you here. But I'm not going to tell the designated social workers all about you. I'm going to allow you to do that. But today we are talking about one of the running themes, which is report writing, a very important aspect of protecting children, ultimately. If designated social workers don't write their reports well, it often has a detrimental impact on the case, because that is our opportunity to communicate to the court, to the presiding officer, and all the other role players, what has happened, what transpired, and what needs to happen next that's in the best interest of the child. So today we're going to talk about two aspects of the court report that designated social workers in South Africa need to write, and they need to write it well. And it's not always easy. Report writing, I think, and this is a personal opinion, is almost like public speaking. It's not something that comes naturally to everyone. And so, although it's very important. And so I'm very excited about this interview. We've interviewed others about report writing, but you are a known trainer in the field of child protection work in South Africa. So we're very, very privileged. So please, maybe just introduce yourself to those designated social workers who don't know you. Just perhaps talk about your background, your years experience, training, etc.
Okay. Well, as Almin said, my name is Sanet Viljoen, and I am a passionate social worker for the past 36 years.
Wow, 36 years. That's long.
All 36 years in child protection.
Wow.
So I've done everything. I was on intake level, removal, placement in foster care supervision worker, reunification worker. I worked in the child and youth care center for 14 years. I was an intermediary.
Sure.
I was a supervisor for child protection social workers, a manager for child protection social workers, a trainer for child protection social workers.
Outstanding. And that is, you know, that is what we do at the Cave. We invite speakers or colleagues, friends, to come and sit around our metaphorical bonfire and to have a conversation about topics that can help designated social workers, our foot soldiers still out there fighting the good fight. So wonderful to hear your rich experience from which you're going to obviously talk to today. Welcome, Sanet, and thank you for making time for the Cave. We really appreciate it.
It's a pleasure.
All right, so we're going to jump in two questions, two topics. The first one for designated social workers listening to this, watching this video, is that they need to write, what was the first topic again, Sanet? I forget. The first topic, I think, is...
Evaluation,
yes. So they've written the introduction, the reasons for statutory intervention, all the profiling of the client, everything that's in the court report, but then they need to evaluate. And I have found even at university, students also struggle with this. It seems to be a tough one. So could you talk about evaluation in a court report, and then also just tell the designated social workers, what five tips do you think they should consider or you know, keep nearby when they start writing that evaluation?
Okay. Well, evaluation, and I'm going to talk a little bit about conclusion, unfortunately, and then a recommendation. We are now moving away from the facts. What is in front of the evaluation are the facts of the report. And now we are going to start interpreting. So evaluation is then your professional opinion as a designated social worker. I would also recommend that social workers refer to themselves in the report as a designated social worker. Then we mirror the terminology in the Children's Act. So the first one is your professional opinion, and the second one is to interpret the evidence. To show the court, why are you coming to that recommendation? Okay, so that is quite interesting, and social workers are really struggling out there. So what are they doing? They're just putting down facts again in their report, in the evaluation. What else do? They they repeat the information, they give facts, and or they make a summary. And a summary does not equal your professional opinion. Something else I think what social workers need to know is that your evaluation is not a short paragraph. It can be a page and longer because it's your professional opinion. So for me, I want us to look back to what is in the facts of the report. Okay? So when we look at the facts, we first discuss the biological parents, the family profile, the biological parents. So we have to evaluate and give our professional opinion about the parents. What our opinion? Then we also talk in our report about the child or the children concerned. What is our professional opinion about the children? What should be in their best interest? And now I've already moved to the next one, the best interest of the child. So if I want to give tips, I've got 6 tips that I want to give.
That's excellent. Yes.
Evaluation.
Excellent.
The first one is, it is not a summary. It is your professional judgment. First one. Second one, it's your thought process. How did you come to this conclusion and this recommendation? So you have to think about it. It's not a cut and paste exercise from a previous report.
Mm-mm.
It's something new. Then if I go to the third one, there's no new facts in the evaluation. And I don't know why social workers do that. That they bring in some new information and then the supervisor who has to screen the reports, where does this come from? So no new facts. Actually, no facts. Then, as I said, we will discuss our parents and our child. So that is the fourth tip I want to give. And say, for instance, we do a report where we also screen the foster parents. We will also give our professional opinion about the prospective foster parents. And then my fifth tip, now you already said it, is use Section 7. We must know what is in the best interest of the child. And I found a practice that social workers don't use Section 7 at all. They don't really know Section 7. They vaguely refer to Section 7. And therefore, my last tip will then be, in your last paragraph, write what is in the best interest of the child. Foster care placement, child and youth care center, return to the parent, and how did you come to that decision? So the last paragraph will then be the best interest of the child.
Okay, yeah, and that makes a lot of sense. And I think the biggest guiding practice tip that they can take with them today is when you write your report, when you write the heading evaluation, make sure you've already provided all the facts so that nothing new comes after evaluation. And now it's about making sense of that facts or those facts using your professional judgment. And would you say your evaluation should also be embedded in theory or literature? Do you think that's supportive? So say, for instance, it's your professional opinion that the child concerned, say, for instance, is suffering from a low self-esteem because of the verbal abuse that's been endured in the home. It's an example. And then you cite literature that has proven the association or the correlation between a low self-esteem and verbal abuse. Would you say that is the ideal place to cite literature research in support of your professional judgment of the facts?
Of course we can do that, Almin. But I would suggest that young social workers just getting into report writing should not try to cite as well. Okay. Just try to get evaluation get that right and then start
yes.
citing, especially in difficult cases.
Yes. Absolutely.
And these days we've got very difficult cases where there are attorneys involved and then we should cite.
Yes.
But we should be careful when we cite.
Yes.
It should be the latest information.
Yeah.
And we must also not just look for information that support our opinion, but also not support our opinion. Because attorneys are very very intelligent, and they will look for something different. That's the opposite than what you're citing.
And that speaks to a topic that we've dealt with here in the bonfire, which is objectivity. But I think that should be a guiding principle throughout a social worker's conduct, investigations, choices, and report writing. It should be clear that the designated social worker is objective. So I agree with you, an acknowledgement of literature that represents opposing views, but then making a decision from the opposing views, what is applicable in this case? Why is it more likely that it's A or B? Okay, good. Any other practice tips when they write evaluations, or anything else you want to help tell them that could help them write a better evaluation?
Well, I think, I mean, they should put time aside. I've always written my evaluations when I'm fresh in the morning. And then I will make sure that there are paragraphs. Social workers can just write one big paragraph or single sentence paragraph. So we also have to look at the construction, how we write it.
Yes.
So definitely the tip will be discuss your parents, your children, and your prospective foster parents.
And then what's in the best interest, yeah.
Yes.
My colleague Ansi Fushir always used to say, so what? So what? And I wonder if that doesn't fit into this conversation, that your evaluation is so what? You've given the facts, fact, but so what? What must the court do with these facts? And that's where the social worker's professional interpretation, like you say, comes into play. What does it mean? What does it possibly predict? So what? I think, I don't know if you agree with that. I think.
Yes, no, definitely. Yeah. And that is where you actually have to give now. Now you show you are professional.
Yes, yes.
By giving your opinion.
I recently attended a training by Helena Berg, and she also said that this is the one opportunity for the designated social worker to make her or his mark and for their voice to come through there, because the entire report, like you say, it's factual. What are the facts of the case? That is not a professional judgment of the social work, although it reveals an investigation you did, or it reflects an investigation you did. But the evaluation is where you make your mark as a professional to say, what does this mean? Yeah. All right, excellent. So the second question relates to recommendations, but you will speak briefly to the conclusion as well, because these follow on each other, your evaluation, your conclusion, and your recommendations. But we're always a bit time constrained here at the Cave. But if you could maybe tell the designated social workers or share some practice wisdom with them in terms of what to consider when you write your conclusion, and then specifically with the recommendations, what legislation from the Children's Act should they always consider when they make their recommendations to the presiding officer?
Okay, so the conclusion is the next reasoning process after the evaluation. If we specifically look at the Children's Court format, Form 38, the conclusion is already written down there. So we just have to complete, is the child in need of care and protection or not? And that is the guidance that we get from Section 150. So we must know what is in Section 150. And there are two options. So Section 150A has got 12 categories. Now, with the Children's Amendment Act, although it's not in practice yet, but is the child orphaned or abandoned? Is the child a street child? Is the child exploited? So I mean that. And then the three new categories are the unaccompanied migrant child, child trafficking, and sale of children. So we need to know, which one are we choosing? Do we have enough facts to choose that specific subsection? Yes.
So number one, when you write your conclusion before your recommendation, make sure you've got Section 150 next to you. Make sure you know it off by heart. I always say to the students, that's one section I think you should know by heart, among others. It was not always possible. But refresh your memory, Section 150, based on the facts, the conclusion is, what is the end result? Is this child in need of care and protection or not? And if yes, according to which paragraph, like you just said?
Yes. And then a tip I want to give there, Almin, is that what I found when I do training is social workers think they know the terminology in terms of the Children's Act. Make sure you are interpreting the terminology correctly. So my guidance and my tip to them always is, go to Section 1. Because section one tells you exactly what it means. Now, if we look at the specific subsection, I want to mention this to you is 1501E, that the child has been exploited. Now we think, okay, so the child is doing a little bit housework at home and looking after the children that are exploited. But what is the definition in section one of exploitation? Then it's not. Same with risk. What is the definition of risk? So we really have to make sure that we understand the definitions before we vaguely think, okay, this child has been neglected, but we don't have facts in the report about neglect. What are the conditions? How does the child look? What is the behavior indicators that the child displays? It should be in the fact of the report, the body of the report. So we must be really very careful what we choose. And I mean, it's not, let's stick as many as possible. I don't know why social workers do that. As many as possible. Let's try to tick everything. Wow, my case is strong. No.
No,
if you've got the facts for it, yeah, then it's strong. Otherwise, not.
Correct.
You open yourself.
A lot of problems, a lot of cross-examination. But so what I'm gathering from you is a golden thread between your facts, section 150, to come to a conclusion. But then before you do that, just go remind yourself of the definitions, and the definitions are very adequately defined in the Children's Act, as you say, in section one. And I would actually say go start there. You know, before you make any decision, before you make come to any professional judgment, make sure, what does it mean to care for a child? So if you say the child is not cared for, are you sure the child is not cared for? Go look at the definition. Or maybe you say the child is cared for, but then when you go look at the definition of care, actually the child's not being cared for. So we should absolutely be guided by ourselves. We need to, like, the court needs to be guided by facts. We need to be guided by facts of the case, and we need to be guided by sound knowledge, literature and legislation. So I think that's an excellent starting point, like you suggest. Go look at the definitions first. Very good point.
Okay. So, and then you just on the form 3 act, you just complete the subsections that you think is applicable. Okay. I also just want to refer to the conclusion refers to section 150 subsection 2, and there are two conditions: child-related household and victim of child labor. And social workers do not know those two terms. They use it very loosely. So back to section one, and also look for the sections in the act that talks about child-headed households and child-headed households and victim of child labor.
Yes, and
so
use it.
We
yeah.
have to know. Yes.
Okay. Yeah, and I think, you know, when you as a designated social worker listening to this recording, you're busy writing your conclusion and you make statements, right? So you say these children are in need of care and protection because they've been exploited, or because they live in conditions that are not conducive to their health and well-being, et cetera, et cetera. Go look for your own evidence in your report that confirms that what you are saying is true, that supports your claim. And if you can't find it in your report, then reconsider. Can you say the child has been exploited? Can you say the child lives in conditions that are not conducive? Which conditions are you talking about? Just go, so it's a dance. So if you say something in your conclusion or in your evaluation, go back to the facts. Where will I find that? And always prepare for the attorney who's going to ask you, based on what? Why do you say that? You've got to be able to justify your evaluation and your conclusion. Sanet, please continue.
Okay, so then we get to the recommendation. Okay, so evaluation, the conclusion comes from the evaluation, and the recommendation comes from the conclusion. Okay, so what is the recommendation? It links up to the evidence that you have given up in the body of the report. And what are you doing now? You're looking at the best outcome for this specific child. So what is in the best interest of the child in detail now? And you really have to be careful about what you are recommending. So for social workers, designated social workers, we must know section 156 of the Children's Act, because that is where we draw our recommendation of if the child is in need of care and protection. If the child is not in need of care and protection, we look at section 46. Okay. if there's still some issues that need to be resolved and can be handled on prevention and early intervention level. So where, if I have to give tips for how do you write your recommendation, I would say it, first one, it should be logical. Let's flow, have a, where to start and where to stop. And it depends on how we write our recommendation. I've prepared something, so I just want to read it from there.
That'll be so, excellent. Just to remind you, we have about 8 minutes left, but please proceed. I think this is going to be golden.
Okay. So you will recommend, it is recommended that should the child, the court find the child in need of care and protection, as you put in your conclusion, that the following orders be made. Okay, so now the court has assessed your report and says, yes, I do agree. So let's hear what the social worker has. And what should happen to the child. So usually in practice, we place children in foster care now. That is what we usually do. And therefore, we must know section 156E, subsection 5. And subsection 2. Mm-hmm. Subsection 5 is about the child and youth care center. I prepared that one as well.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now I'm stuck.
So I think that the most important thing with a recommendation is, first of all, the designated social workers understand we don't instruct the court and we don't make the final decision. It is a recommendation. We've provided the facts. We've provided our professional interpretation. We've drawn a conclusion. And now we make a recommendation. And I agree with you, Sanet, that when we the words we use and how we phrase it is something like you said, along the lines of the undersigned designated social worker respectfully recommends that the children's court or the name of the presiding officer consider the following recommendations should the court find the child concerned to be in need of care protection. And then you literally cite from either those two different sections in the Children's Act, depending on the case, the orders that have to be made. So whether it's a supervision order or whether it's an order for the parents to attend a rehabilitation, whether it's an order for the child to remain in the care of the current place of safety parent pending another round of investigations, whatever it might be. Then you literally, I always suggest bullet points or numbering, give it sweet and short. What is the recommendation? This order, this order, this order. And then also depending on the case, I think it's important for professional designated social workers to use their discretion. If there's a need for additional recommendations, such as something to be considered in terms of contact arrangements, something that you want to highlight at this point, use your discretion. But yeah, I think that's the basics regarding recommendations.
Yes. So as you said, who's going to render the service, the foster care supervision as well as the unification services?
Yes.
Also, should there be an interdict? That is an interesting one that social workers rarely use.
Yeah.
Because 156K talks about interdicting a person to have contact with the child.
Yes.
It's not in the best interest of the child. So we must remember that one as well. We can also make a recommendation if there's not a birth certificate.
Yes.
Yet.
Yes.
That the estimation of the child be used to apply for a birth certificate. So very specific and logical that we have to be.
Yes. So if the designated social workers watching this, they always struggle with evaluation, recommendations. Go look at the basic, go take your Children's Act, go look at the definitions, go look at those two sections, Sanet. Maybe just want to repeat though for recommendations. It's 156 and
156.
46. Yes. Go read up on those. Go familiarize yourself with those recommendations, the definitions. And I think that's going to make it just a whole lot easier.
Yes. It is unfortunate you have to go and do your research.
Yes.
And social workers, we need to have court report writing skills.
Yes, absolutely.
Because that, as you just now said, the evaluation is our voice, but also the report is our voice.
Yes, absolutely.
Our professional voice.
Absolutely.
So we need to get those report writing skills and apply them in practice.
Absolutely. If I can summarize some of the essential points that you shared with us today, Your evaluation is your professional interpretation of the facts. No new facts are presented in your evaluation. Your evaluation and everything else must be clear that it's objective. And when applicable, use literature or theory to support your judgment of the facts. And you make a judgment of the child, the family, or other role players, and the incidences that occurred. Say, for instance, it was physical violence, and then your conclusion is: so what? Is this child now in need of care and protection or not? Yes or no? And if you say yes, why do you say it? And use legislation, section 150, to substantiate. And when you write that down and you say, yes, this child's in need of care protection according to section 151B, that's your conclusion. It's the bottom line. Go back to the facts and make sure, is the child in need of care protection based on that paragraph? And then your recommendations, it's a humble request to be contemplated. It's not an instruction. And very specific two sets of legislations that tell us what orders can be made. You pick the ones that, like you said, that are logical and would be also serve the best interest of the child. Oh, yes. And the best interest of the child, again, in the end of your evaluation. Yes.
Yes.
Oh, Sanet, it felt brief, but it was rich. And I think if every designated social worker just watch this when they write a report, specifically those three components, I think if they just apply what they've learned from you today, it'll go well, you know? So thank you. That was brilliant. Is there anything else you'd like to add to those components before I ask you one final question?
I always tell to the social workers, unfortunately, you have to start liking writing reports because you will do it forever. I mean, myself, I also write reports, but it's a different kind of report. So just get the skills under your skin and just apply it in practice.
Yes, absolutely.
While you are still young.
Absolutely. Sanet, before I say goodbye, once again, thank you for your time and sharing your experience with the social workers. Would you like to say anything to a designated social worker who's watching this interview right now, who's maybe fresh out of varsity? Maybe it's her first 6 months in the field, or maybe you are talking to a seasoned colleague who's been there for 30 years. What message would you like to give to our designated social workers out there?
Well, firstly, I know it's a lot of work. If we really have to do what legislation and government expects from us, it's a lot of work. Because remember, out of this comes from more assessments. It is your safety assessments, your risk assessments, your care plans, IDPs, permanency plans, and so forth. And it's very overwhelming. And unfortunately, there's no shortcuts.
Yeah.
So I want to say to all these social workers, thank you for what you are doing. Thank you for what you are trying to do, because it is in the best interest of our children. Just keep it up. Try to capacitate yourself the whole time, improve yourself the whole time, and let's see what comes from it.
Yes,
we can do it.
Yes, we can. And yeah, that's what the CABE is about. We know about every designated social worker out there working very hard to protect children and enduring a lot of criticism and working under extremely difficult circumstances. So yeah, I can only echo what you say, Sanet. Thank you for every social worker out there. Sanet, I don't want to take more of your time. Thank you so much for visiting us here at the CAVE. We will definitely chat to you again soon. And yeah, have a lovely weekend further.
Thank you very much, Almin.
Bye-bye.